lovely to be here with you all, and to see you at the back as well. So I hope you could, if you stop being able to hear me, wave, and I'll talk up and see if we can make it audible. Some of you will have been at my talk yesterday, and when I was in my talk yesterday, we began exploring the whole question of Moses and Moses turning aside at the burning bush. Today is a parallel talk. You don't need to have been here yesterday for it to make sense. If you were here yesterday, you'll see that it kind of picks up on the same themes and explores them in a slightly different way. So for those of you who weren't here yesterday, we will begin to explore actually how do you begin to encounter God in the ordinary, in the everyday? How do we begin to experience God in our everyday lives rather than our Sunday best polished up lives? And one of the themes I think is really important when we begin to think about exploring God and engaging with God, encountering God, is one of my favourite words. You won't hear me say this very often, so just be ready. One of my favourite words from the prayer book. Doesn't happen all that often, as I say, but one of my favourite words from the prayer book is in the ordinal, which is where people, where the prayer book is talking about what is expected of people who are ordained in the Church of England, which I'm not, so I can always read it with great entertainment because that's not for me. But one of the words that they use is of people who need to be sentinels. And sentinels isn't really a word we use very much today, but I love it. It's a great word. Because sentinels are really, really important people. And in the ancient world, they were hugely significant people. You see, what a sentinel would do is you would have a sentinel in each town or city. And the sentinel's job would be to be right on the top of the city walls. And the sentinel needed to have various characteristics about them that made them really good sentinels. I, incidentally, would be a terrible sentinel because I'm about to tell you the characteristics you need. But one of the characteristics you need to be a good sentinel is you need absolute patience, because the purpose of a sentinel was to watch for the enemy coming. So you would be there on the city walls watching for the enemy approaching. But you don't just need patience. You also needed to be somebody who was really good at interpretation. Because you would see, possibly, a little dust cloud appearing over the horizon. And at that point, it became really, really significant that you could be the kind of person who could work out what kind of dust cloud you were looking at. Because if you saw a dust cloud and you ran down or blew your horn or did whatever the sentinels did to draw attention, and it turned out that it was just a dust cloud, then you would be a vastly unpopular person. The point of a sentinel is you are able to see something coming from a far distance, to interpret what it is, so to recognise when it's an enemy and when it's just a dust cloud and nothing to worry about, and then be somebody that people could listen to, then be somebody that actually people would engage with. And there are two people in the gospel narratives who I think illustrate to us what being a really great sentinel looks like. And they are two of my favourite characters from Luke's gospel. And I just want to spend a moment reflecting on them with you before we go on and think a little bit more about glory and the importance of glory. And these two people are Simeon and Anna. Simeon and Anna in the temple, and many of you will know the story. It's a great story. Is that Simeon and Anna are in the temple and Jesus arrived. And Simeon and Anna were able to recognize who Jesus was and to go and proclaim who Jesus was to everybody who was around, who was waiting for Jesus or waiting for the redemption of Israel. Now, you see, we're really familiar with this story, and we go, well, of course they recognise Jesus. Why wouldn't they recognise Jesus? Jesus was very significant. But just stop for a moment and think about the story, because I think the story is a really, really intriguing one. And in order to get into it, you need to see it in your mind's eye. So if you can, start to conjure up for yourself the picture of Simeon and Anna in your mind's eye. So they're in the temple, there they are, Simeon and Anna, and Jesus and his mother and father arrive in the temple. Now I wonder what your picture looks like. Have you got one? Are you there? You're picturing it. I wonder what's in your picture. Is it a large cathedral-looking building? Because if it is, chuck it out. Are they there nicely, peacefully on their own? There's just Simeon in one corner, Anna in the other corner, Jesus and his parents arriving through the door. If that's in your head, chuck it out. What's really, really important to bear in mind about the temple is the temple is enormous. By the time of the first century, by the time King Herod's messed around with it thoroughly, it is a huge complex. Now, when there was a major feast, something like Passover, the historian Josephus estimates that there would have been, on average, 20,000 priests on duty at the temple at any one time. So take out of your head any nice, quiet, reflective, meditative space and put in instead an enormous teeming mass of people. And bear in mind that the reason why you come to the temple in the Middle East, where it's very, very hot, is to sacrifice your animals. So there are animals running around, there's vast amount of noise, there's blood pouring about all over the place. The smell is horrific. And there are thousands and thousands of people present. Now, actually, we don't know exactly when Jesus did come to the temple at this particular moment. So there may not have been the 20,000. There may have been just the 2,000 priests on duty at that particular point. But nevertheless, the point is still made. This is an enormously busy place. And if you remember, what both Simeon and Anna were able to do was to see the baby Jesus and say, "There is salvation." Now let's just stop for a moment and listen to what actually that says. If you know the words of the Nunc Dimittis, what Simeon says, "Now let thy servant depart in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation." You need to hear what he says, because I don't know about you, but for years I heard the word salvation and said saviour in my head. So what Simeon said is, "Here's a baby and I see my saviour." But he doesn't say that. He says, "I see salvation." Bear in mind, Jesus at this point is 40 days old. He hasn't done a lot yet. There's probably been quite a lot of crying, quite a lot of sicking, quite a lot of pooing. But apart from that, not a lot else. So one of the things that I think is really, really intriguing is when we talk about salvation and what Jesus has done, often we talk about it in terms of an action. Jesus did. Jesus hasn't done anything other than just turn up at that point. And yet Simeon can say, "My eyes have seen your salvation." And it seems to me there's something really, really significant in us stopping and reflecting on how we can become people like Simeon and Anna, who can be like that kind of a person, who can be that kind of recognizer of God. Because you see, Simeon and Anna, because they were first century Jews, would have had an idea in their mind about what they were going to encounter. When the one who came to redeem Israel came, they almost certainly had a clear idea of what that person would look like or be like. He would probably be some kind of military leader. Almost certainly some kind of king-like figure, failing a king-like figure, definitely an angel kind of figure, that kind of person who was going to come, that were going to lead an army, they're going to drive the Romans out of Israel. And somehow, amazingly, miraculously, when they had this expectation of this great military king-like figure coming to drive the Romans out of Israel, they were able to look at a 40-day-old baby and say, "There he is." Just stop and think about what remarkable acuity, what remarkable kind of powers of observation, what remarkable skills of being sentinels they had to have an expectation of what God was going to look like and see him in the form of a baby. And for me, one of the really important questions is, how do we learn to the characteristics that people like Simeon and Anna had so that when God turns up, we are able to say, "I see salvation. There I see signs of God. There I see glimpses of glory." What is it that allows you to be that kind of person? Because there's one thing that I know about God with absolute certainty, which is that God always appears in the place you don't expect God to be. And God always appears doing the kind of things you don't expect God to do. God always appears looking like you don't expect God to be. The one thing I know about God is unexpected. So therefore, we need to be like Simeon and Anna if we want to have hope of encountering God. So what does Luke tell us? What does Luke tell us about the kind of people that Simeon and Anna were? Slightly gloriously, he tells us that they were two entirely different people. If you want to have an expectation of the kind of person who's going to be a really good sentinel, Luke says, well, they could be like this or they could be like that. One of the really fascinating features I often find when people talk about Simeon is that they assume that Simeon and Anna are somehow squelched together as a single person. And you would expect me to say this, but I get slightly irritated, is that Simeon gets to take over all of Anna's characteristics so that Anna just stands in the background and Simeon is held up as this great figure. So sometimes you hear Simeon described as being a prophet. Actually, Luke doesn't say Simeon was a prophet, it says Anna was a prophet. Also, and this is the really intriguing thing, we always assume that Simeon's old. When you had your mental picture of Simeon and Anna, was he an old man? Probably yes, because all the artwork says. But what's really intriguing is Luke doesn't tell us Simeon was old. All you've got in Luke to suggest that Simeon might have been old was, "Now let your servant go in peace." And we assume that means he was a really old man and ready just to lay down and have a bit of a sleep for a long time. But actually, it could be that Simeon had felt constrained by God and now could say, having been constrained by God, you can let me off the hook, thank you, and I can go off and do something else. Don't know about you, but I often feel like that with God. So what if Simeon was 18 and Anna was really, really old? We don't know for certain, but it is an interesting what-if question. So what do we know about Simeon? Frustratingly, very little indeed. Simeon apparently lived in Jerusalem, and he was driven into the temple by the Spirit because Jesus was about to arrive. So Simeon was your charismatic sentinel. He was the one who was inspired by the Spirit and sent by God to encounter Jesus. Anna, on the other hand, was your academic. Take a wild stab in the dark, who's my favourite? The charismatic man or the academic woman? It's a tough one, isn't it? Anna is a fascinating character and far, far underappreciated, I think. Anna, we're told, is a prophet. She has spent her time, it doesn't say exactly how long, but she has spent her time in the temple fasting and praying and looking for the coming of Jesus. She has been studying and praying and waiting. The other thing I love about Anna is she's the one who is really, really, really old. And the thing I love about the commentaries on Anna is that they have this really long discussion about precisely how old Anna is, because the text isn't entirely clear. The text says that she is a widow of 84 years. Now, the natural assumption of that, if you read it normally in another kind of context, is that when it says that she was married for 7 years and then a widow of 84 years. What you would normally assume by that, if you read it in another kind of context, is that she had been married, then she was, she got married, she was then married for 7 years, and then she'd been a widow for 84 years. If you estimate that she got married at the age of 12, this made her 103. So scholars go, that's a bit old, isn't it? Maybe she's just 84, maybe Luke just didn't quite say it right. We don't know. But it either means that Anna was very old, or very, very, very old. Doesn't really matter which one you go with. She was knocking on a bit. But what is wonderful about Anna is here is the picture of a woman who has lived her life faithfully and in deep dedication to God, fasting and praying. And through that length of deep prayer and dedication to God, then she is able to recognise God. So you've got these two lovely contrasting pictures of people who are able to recognise God. Someone who is inspired by the Spirit and someone who is well and truly prepared. So it's almost as though Luke is saying, it doesn't really matter exactly how you place yourself here. If you are ready and have the right capacity, then you will be able to recognise God when God appears in the most unexpected guise. So what is it that allows them to recognise Jesus in this particular context? I would want to suggest there's lots of reasons, but there's one that I just want to focus on now, and that is glory. I love the word glory. A little indication of how much I love the word glory is I was entertained to notice when I was looking at my notes. I often write my notes and look back in them and go, oh, that's interesting. That tells me something about what was going on in my head while I was writing them. I have written in my notes, glory is a glorious word. So clearly I'm thinking glory is kind of glorious in that some kind of way. But I think that what we discover about Simeon and Anna is they are very good glimpses of glory. They are a people who are expert at being able to recognise glory when they encounter it, whether it be by being inspired by the Spirit, whether it be by long years of practice and waiting. Either way, they are glimpses of glory. Now, the word glory. The word glory is a really interesting one, don't you think? Because if I say to you, do you know what the word glory means? I think you would probably say, yes, 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 we know what the word glory means. If I were feeling mean, I might then say, so define it then. And what's really interesting is when you do that, people often go, well, it's kind of glorious, isn't it? It's a kind of a glory thing, and it's and then you begin to run out of words. So let me stop for a moment and begin to try and define glory for you, because it's a really, really significant word in the Bible and helps us to understand something really important, I think, about who God is and how we encounter God. Many of you will know that the Hebrew word for glory is the word kavod. And the word kavod, shock news, is connected to the Hebrew word kaved. You couldn't have worked that out for yourself, could you? The Hebrew word kaved is a verb. And it means to be heavy. And so the word kavod means heaviness or weightiness. And what's really interesting about the word kavod is when it's used of God in the Old Testament, it's translated glory. When it's used of anybody else, it's translated differently. And it's one of those things that slightly irritates me about being able to kind of trace your way through the English translations. And when it's used of other people in the Old Testament, it's used to mean their reputation, who they are, how you understand them. It is their weightiness. So then when you take it back into God, you begin to understand what it's telling us about this word glory. Glory is God's weightiness. Glory is that of God that we can encounter, as opposed to all the other stuff of God that we can't encounter. Glory is that of God which is his reputation, his impressiveness, that of God which we can encounter. So glory, as you see, is a really significant word because it's that which we can make, kind of understand of God, that which we can meet of God. And what's really interesting is if you trace the word glory through the Bible and then onwards into the New Testament, what you discover is that the word glory gets an extra resonance to it when it's applied to God. One of the things that you will know, I'm sure, is that when God appears in the Old Testament, he always comes with some form of weather phenomena attached. I don't know if you've ever noticed that. So God appears and there's earthquakes, or there's lightning, or there's hail, or there's fire. And God often appears with some sort of big phenomena. And most often, God appears with light. And therefore, God's glory becomes associated with light. And therefore, you get, by the time you get into the New Testament tradition, if you remember the Lucan birth narratives, those innocent shepherds were sitting on the hill, minding their own business, looking after the sheep. The angel appeared and glory shone. By that point, glory has become so associated with light that if you ask someone what glory does, glory shines. So therefore you have that shininess of glory. So you get that kind of lovely image that glory is who God is. But who God is so majestic and so wonderful and associated with these weather phenomena that actually glory must shine. One of our favourite films in our family is Stardust. I don't know if any of you know Stardust. I adore Stardust. I've watched it about 16 times and still haven't got bored of it. And in case you don't know the story, it's a kind of really odd, quirky little fairy tale in which a star gets knocked out of the heaven and arrives on Earth as a girl, and she meets a boy and la-da-da-da-da. But at the end, they need something dramatic to happen, and in the end she says, I've got to do what stars do. And she shines. And it always reminds me of glory. Glory has to shine. The glory of God must shine, because God can't do anything else but be splendorous and shine. So glory is God's weightiness, God's impressiveness, and God glory shines in the world. And the final little thing about glory, before I move on and reflect a little bit more on the importance of this, is I don't know if you've ever reflected on the question of why are we invited in the biblical narrative to give glory to God? It's one of those really odd things. There's a whole load of things that are strung together which are fascinating to me about why we're invited to give glory to God, why we're invited to bless God, and why does God need blessing from me? Why does God need any glory from me? I would say that surely God has plenty glory already. I always think that kind of being invited to give glory to God is like inviting to bring quiche to a church supper. You know, there's plenty already. You know, you don't need, God doesn't need, you know, we're not saying God's kind of half topped up on glory today. What he needs is a bit more from us and he'll be doing well. Actually, giving glory is a really important theological idea, and for me it's a really significant one. Of course we're not giving glory to God in that God has any lack of glory. When we give glory to God, we are recognising God to be who God really is. So giving glory to God is about recognising God's weightiness, God's reputation. When we recognise who God really is, and we proclaim who we think God really is, that's when we give glory to God. There's that something which is the kind of the connectedness about us giving glory to God. But it's also a wonderful image that the God who is in his very essence glorious is prepared to invite us to give him glory. It's a kind of remarkable image which is worth reflecting on. So how do we glimpse glory? How do we become people who are really good at glimpsing the things of God? As I've said already earlier on, one of the really striking things about God in the biblical tradition is God is always surprising. God is always unexpected. So how do we begin to become people who are expert in the glimpsing of glory? How do we become people who are expert in encountering God? There's one thing that I want to begin by reflecting with you on, and then I want to move on to another biblical passage. The first thing that I want to say is, shock news, I'm sure you don't know this already, but I'm really passionate about the Bible. And the reason why I'm really passionate about the Bible, well, there's kind of 580 reasons why I'm passionate about the Bible, but the top of my list of why I'm really passionate about the Bible is because the Bible helps us to understand who God is. One of the really striking things to me about the way in which the Bible talks about God is if I were to invite many of us today, and if I said to you, can you give me some descriptions of God? What we normally default into in our modern Western world is we use abstract nouns of God. God is love. God is compassion. God is, and we use an abstract noun, and it's largely helpful, but only largely helpful. If you have a look in the biblical tradition, they hardly ever use an abstract noun of God. If you wanted to ask a biblical writer who is God, what they would say is, God is the God who freed his people from slavery. God is the God who brings people into the promised land. God is the God who raised Jesus from the death. You may, from the dead. You may recognize the phrases from the biblical tradition. People in the Bible tell you who God is by what God has done. It's not an abstract noun description. It's an action description. How do we know who God is? We know who God is by what God has done. We know that God who has done that will do it again and again and again. And that God is the God that we can encounter. So if we want to become people who are better at glimpsing glory, we need to know what God does. And if we know that God is the God who brings freedom where there is slavery, then we need to look for where freedom is happening in the world, and we can be pretty confident there we will find God. If we know that God is the God who brings life out of death, we need to look into situations where there seems to be absolute death and to see where we can encounter those things of God. So the reason I'm passionate about the Bible, like I say, there are many reasons, but one of the top of the list of the reasons is because if we want to know who God is, the way in which we'll discover who God is by reading the Bible, because it will tell us the stories about what God does. And one of the things that seems to me to be a really significant thing is as we become people who are expert about telling the stories of God, we can start adding our own. We can start saying, the God who was the God who did this is the God who did this for me. And I don't know about you, but one of the things that happens is the more you notice something, this is a really obvious thing to say, but it makes sense once I get it out. The more you notice something, the more you notice something. Like I say, very blindingly obvious thing, but it is really, really striking. I don't know if you've ever noticed, if you, say, for example, have never seen a flower before, and you suddenly see a flower, then for the next week you always see that flower, even though you were pretty confident you've never seen it before in your life. And it seems to me that actually if we want to be expert glimpses of God, we need to be people who notice God more. We need to develop a habit of saying, today I saw God. One of the things I try and do regularly is a little kind of a tweaked version of the Ignatius Examen. Some of you will know about the Ignatius Examen. I love the Ignatius Examen as a simple way of weaving prayer into my daily life. The Ignatius Examen, in its most simple form, is when you get to the end of the day, you recall your day, and you recall those things that have brought life to you, and you recall those things that have drained you of life, and you lay them before God. What I like to do is tweak it a little bit, and while doing both of those things, also say to myself, today I saw God, ... and rehearse those occasions when I feel that I caught a glimpse of glory. Because, you see, then the next day, I'm more alert to the glimpse of glory that I saw the last day. And then the next day, I see more of those glimpses. One of the things I'm often struck by is gossip. I know women have a great reputation for gossip, and I must admit, I love gossip. It's great. There's nothing I adore more. Nice big pot of tea on the table, cups around, cake makes the gossip even better, but you get the idea. You're sitting around and you begin to share stuff. The problem is that gossip can be both really, really good and really, really bad. And when gossip goes wrong, gossip gossips bad news. There was a friend I used to have who in the end I had to stop going to visit because she only ever told me bad stuff. I live in a place called Bourneville, which some of you may have heard of. You need to know that it's rather unfortunate because I'm also a chocoholic. So it is really, really... In fact, this is nothing to do with my talk, but one of the things I struggle with is every Lent I give up chocolate because it's a really important internal discipline. And I travel a lot, and between the our house and the train station is the Cadbury factory. And it is true that when you walk past the Cadbury factory, it smells like chocolate. In fact, if you are as much of a chocoholic as I am, if I tell you it smells like a flake the moment when you just open it, that's what it smells like. Between the train station and my house, and really, unfortunately, it goes the train station, the Cadbury factory, the newsagents, my house. And you have no idea in Lent how hard it is to be the person who walks past the Cadbury factory, past the newsagents, and into my house without the consumption of chocolate. I have no idea why I told you that now. I've distracted myself completely. Oh, I know, yes. So I live in Bourneville, Cadbury land. Bourneville is a lovely area. It is a hugely inspirational area to live in because it was shaped by Christian vision 100 years ago by the Quakers. And as a result, the community still works in an enormously inspirational way. But this friend that I used to go and see would know every bad thing that had happened within a 2-mile radius of our house, which she would start on the moment I came through the door. And by the time I left, I was terrified of living in Bourneville. I was convinced I was going to be knifed, I was going to be mugged, I was going to have my car stolen. And the problem was that the gossip became worse and worse. And so what happened was that I was constantly looking out for all the bad things that existed in the place that I live. And what it taught me was a really important lesson, which is that if you gossip bad news, you become a sentinel of bad news. You become somebody who recognises bad news everywhere. If you gossip good news, then you become a sentinel of good news. And for me, one of the really important spiritual disciplines, yesterday I was talking about the spiritual discipline of curiosity. Today, I want to talk about the spiritual discipline of gossiping good news. Gossiping the good stuff. Gossiping what God is doing in our world. Gossiping the great news about the people we know, about the things that happen. It's still gossip and it's still enormously fun, but actually it changes the way in which you see the world. It changes actually how we encounter things. So that we become people who are really good at glimpsing glory. We are people who become transformed by our glimpses of glory. Let me move on now to my final point, which involves reflecting on two different biblical passages which kind of pick this up. Because I think what happens when you start to gossip good news is you start becoming infected by glory. One of my favourite passages which reflects this is Exodus 34. Exodus 34 is one of those kind of weird bits of Exodus where Moses is popping up and down Mount Sinai to get an extra little bit of law, and then he comes back down and then he goes back up. If you've ever been to Mount Sinai, you will be incredibly admiring of Moses's athletic skill to be popping up to the top of Mount Sinai, popping down, popping up, popping down. But at this point, he's up and down into the presence of God. And what's really wonderful about the passage of Exodus 34 is that as Moses goes to the top of the mountain and he spends time in the presence of God, when he comes down, his face is shining. It's a lovely, lovely story. So he's at the top of the mountain encountering God, and when he comes down from the top of the mountain, his face shines. Incidentally, if you know anything about medieval art and medieval architecture, you may be aware of the fact that Moses often is depicted with horns. And it is a lovely, lovely mistranslation of the Hebrew. And it's just one of those kind of little indications of how people often say to me, what do you think is the most important technique you should use in good translation? I often say common sense. This is where the common sense gene broke down in St. Jerome. Because the word in Hebrew for shine can also mean horns. And so when St. Jerome was translating into Latin this particular passage of Exodus 34, instead of saying Moses' face shone, he said Moses' face was horned. And so all the medieval artwork has Moses with horns. And you want to go... It must have been really late one night, mustn't it? That it occurred to Jerome that it was more likely that the Hebrew meant he had horns than that his face was shining. It's just a lovely, lovely image. So Moses, he gets to the top of the mountain and he spends time with God and his face shone. What that means is God's glory is infectious. You spend time in the presence of God and you are infected by what makes God's glory God's glory. What's the essence of God's glory? God's glory shines like stars do. So God's glory is essentially shiny. So when Moses encounters the full glory of God, what happens to Moses? He shines. It's a lovely, lovely image. And I don't know about you, but I know a few shiny people. Those people who are the people who spend a lot of time in the presence of God, and they shine. There is something about them that radiates. And what I think is really important about our Christian journey is to become shiny people. Shiny people like Exodus 34 is talking about. And what is fascinating is that Paul, when he's thinking about this passage, picks it up in 2 Corinthians 3. And some of you will know 2 Corinthians 3 well. It's a lovely chapter. And it's intriguing in all sorts of ways. And one of the ways in which 2 Corinthians 3 is intriguing is that it appears to be an early example of Paul doing his own exegesis. And some scholars think that it might, in fact, 2 Corinthians 3, be one of Paul's early sermons. So what we know from Acts is that when Paul goes to a place for the first time, he went into the synagogue. And he would expound with the Jews in the synagogue. And one of the things those of us who are sad and New Testament scholars like me always want to know is, what did he say? What did Paul do when he went into the synagogue? One theory is 2 Corinthians 3 is an indication of what Paul did say when he was in the synagogue. Those of you who preach may know that you don't always just use your sermons once. It may be that Paul has developed this habit at an early age, that actually he too used his early one of his synagogue sermons in 2 Corinthians 3. And the reason why this is really interesting is he is expounding Exodus 34. And we haven't got the time to look at it in detail. And if you're interested enough, do go home. But you never thought you'd hear me say this. Go home and read Exodus 34 and then 2 Corinthians 3 and you'll see what I mean. I seriously do mean it. I hope you'll kind of see what's going on there. And what you can see is Paul is playing with the themes of the shininess of Moses' face. And what happens in 2 Corinthians 3 is Paul kind of is playing with the idea of what happens when glory occurs, what happens when glory begins to shine. And one of the things that he begins to do is begin to think about veils, which we won't talk about this evening because they're kind of rather complicated in 2 Corinthians 3. But there's something really beautiful and really significant happens when Paul gets close to the end of 2 Corinthians 3. He's been talking about Moses and shininess and glory and the importance of that. And then he says, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now, that is a direct quotation from Exodus 34, because what Exodus 34 says is when Moses goes to the top of the mountain, he would encounter God, and then when he came down from the mountain, his face would be veiled. And then when he went back up to the mountain, he took his veil off again and he encountered God. But what Paul does in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 16, is he suddenly does a remarkable bit of sideways step of exegesis, which for those of us who care about these things get really excited about. Because the really important thing about Moses is that only Moses could encounter God. Only Moses could go to the top of the hill. And by the time you get later on in your Jewish tradition, it becomes a really significant thing that special Jewish men were the ones who could encounter God. What Paul says in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 16, is when anyone turns to the Lord, they encounter the glory of God. And what Paul is saying is, actually, any of you can now have a Moses experience. Any of you can stand in the presence of God and be infected by the glory of God. And then he goes on in verse 18, which is probably the most famous verse of 2 Corinthians 3, which many of you will know. And I'm just going to read it to you, to remind you of it. And in case you're thinking I don't recognise this translation, you won't, because it's mine. And I translated like this because I want to pull out a few things for you, because I think it's a really, really significant verse. Every now and then people say to me, what's your favourite verse? And it sends me into an apoplexy. It's like saying, what's your favourite chocolate? Can't be done. But this is one of my top 10 favourite verses. So let me read it first and I'll explain it to you. And we all, with faces that have been unveiled, gaze and reflect the glory of the Lord. We are being transfigured into the same image from glory into glory, just as from the Lord the Spirit. What Paul's talking about there is this wonderful theological idea, which for me is kind of what keeps me going in my spiritual journey, is that we stand in the presence of God. And just stop for a moment and let me say this again. I've said it once, but let me say it again, because you really have to appreciate quite how important it is. Special Jewish men could stand in the presence of God and be infected by the glory of God. Paul says, and we all. In case you haven't noticed, I'm not a special Jewish man. There may be a special Jewish man in our audience today, which would be lovely, but most of us can't claim that for one or more reasons. I have all three. But Paul says, and we all, forget the notion now that there is special privilege for particular people within a Jew, within a Christian tradition, within a Jewish tradition, within a faith tradition. Actually, now it is available for all of us to stand in the presence of God and be infected by the glory of God. And then he goes on and says, well, what does he say? There's a really interesting one. I've translated it as "we gaze on and reflect." It's a pretty much a rule of thumb in the New Testament that the more important a word is, the harder it is to put it into English. And this is one of those words. The Greek word, in case you're interested, I'm sure you're all sitting there going, now I wonder what that Greek word is. Let me tell you. It's the Greek word katoptrizomenoi, which is lovely, isn't it? Doesn't that sound great? And the Greek word katoptrizomenoi can either be translated as "we gaze on," or it can be translated as "we reflect." If you know about these technical things, it's a middle. And what middles do, they're kind of a self-reflexive verb. So it can either mean "we look at," or it can mean "we reflect." And if you get the idea, gazing and reflecting are a similar kind of thing. Think about a mirror. When you are looking at a mirror, are you gazing or are you reflecting? The answer is yes, of course you are. The point about it is you gaze, and as you gaze, you reflect. And as you reflect, you gaze. And as you gaze, you reflect. It's like one of those kind of lovely conundrums that you had as a child. You know, you have two mirrors next to each other and they go smaller and smaller off into infinity. What Paul is saying here is we all, with faces, both gaze on the glory of God. And as we gaze on the glory of God, we reflect the glory of God. And as we reflect the glory of God, we gaze on the glory of God. And as we gaze on the glory of God, we reflect the glory of God. So if you want to know how you glimpse the glory of God, can I just say I am basking currently in the glorious splendour of the glory of God. What Paul says is that we can all now stand unveiled in God's presence, behold and reflect and behold that glorious splendour of the deep essence of God. And it's such a beautiful, beautiful image that what Paul has in his mind is that glimpsing glory for those who are in Christ has become phenomenally easy. What we need to do is look in the faces of our brothers and sisters, and there we see unveiled glory, the true essence of who God is. And it's a remarkable and really quite challenging piece of theology for us to think about. And yes, I'm not just saying that you find God in the brothers and sisters who are in Christ, but it is an important thing that Paul is saying, that we need to become people who are really good at looking for glimpses of glory in the faces that we see around us. And if we want to become people who gossip good news, people who are really good at telling the good news of God, we need to be good at looking at the faces of people and seeing in them God's great glory in the world. And as we see that, then we begin to gaze on it. And as we gaze on it, then we ourselves begin to reflect it. It is a kind of a beautiful image. And I don't know about you, but it is something that I find enormously inspiring as a vision of the community of Christians and enormously challenging. Just think about your own Christian community if you have one, or if you don't have one, other people that you know who are people of faith. Can you honestly say there is a glorious picture of the image of God? Can you honestly say that in those faces we truly encounter who God is? And it's, like I say, it's an inspiring and challenging. On the one hand, the inspiring bit is look a bit harder. If you go, no, I've looked out, there's definitely no glory today. The answer is, well, you're not looking hard enough. Look back. Can you see it now? The challenging bit is, what if actually there's not a lot of glory shining in our world? What if actually we are the people who are preventing that glory shining forth? And there seems to me to be kind of a virtuous and unvirtuous circle going on. If we are people who are good at glimpsing glory, then we are people who become people who are reflecting glory. And as we reflect it, we're better at glimpsing it. And as we glimpse it, we're better at reflecting it, and on it goes. But actually, if we become communities where the glory fades, then actually we are communities in which God's glory is not shining forth in the world. And that seems to me to be a terrible, terrible crime, a terrible sin, I would put it in such words, that actually we are preventing the glory of God shining in the world. One of my favourite hymns, I'll be finished in a moment, one of my favourite hymns is Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. And it ends with that spine-tingly words, "'Tis only the splendour of light hideth thee." And one of the things I often wonder about is actually whether it's not quite true, and whether what is really hiding God is the splendour of Christians. When we become splendorous in our own eyes, when we are shining our own glory, maybe that's when the glory of God is hidden from our eyes. And what would happen if we could become more people who are infected by the glory of God, who become people who are so much in God's presence that we shine God's glory out into the world? We become good at seeing it, we become good at reflecting it, and as we reflect it, then the glory begins to grow and grow and shine and shine. What if we become that kind of people? Let me end by reading 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18 again for you so we can stop and reflect on it. And then we should have about 15 minutes or so for questions, comments, observations, disagreements, and all those kind of fun things as we begin to kind of move onwards. But let me end by reading to you 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18 again. "And we all, with faces that have been unveiled, gaze and reflect on the glory of the Lord. We are being transfigured into the same image from glory into glory, just as from the Lord, the Spirit." Amen.